while this gets set up, you know, I would say I'm fortunate enough to have my presentation after this panel discussion, because all that got discussed in terms of the threats that we have, the awareness being low and so on, I'm going to substantiate this with some figures, okay? And this is not going to, you know, scare you all, but it's just to get you to the perception and reality that how deep is this problem, okay? Before we get into the presentation, I just want to take a quick poll. We talked about awareness a lot in the last panel discussion. How many of us out here use smartphones? Almost everybody, right? Okay. How many of us actually have antivirus on the phones? You can see 10%, right? The awareness is quite low, right? We do banking transactions. We do almost everything on our phone. I mean, I haven't touched my iPad or something for quite a while now, just because a lot of things are available on the phone. And when we use this for our daily purpose, we just forget that we need to secure that as well, right? So that's the level of awareness that we have today in terms of our devices that we use, right? So what's the threat landscape that we are talking about? Can we just settle down, people at the back? Okay, thanks. So the point is, what is the threat awareness that, what is the landscape that we are talking about? What malwares we are talking about in terms of detection? Okay, so if you see these figures out here, this are the number of malwares that have got detected, and this is through our internal data, in terms of the number of malwares that are getting detected per day, okay? This is the scale of the issue that we are talking about. It's not about a small attack. It's the scale that, it's the scale that we have recorded within our database. We're talking about 3 lakh, oh, this pointer doesn't work, but it's about 3,20,000 malwares that get detected every day, okay? And people from the industry, you know that we started talking cybersecurity, and the importance of the cybersecurity started coming in only by around 2014. Okay, it was there with reference to endpoint security and so on. But in 2014, we started really talking about cybersecurity. And one of the reasons why we did that is because look at the number of attacks that actually happened in 2014. And that brought a lot of relevance of cybersecurity to the overall industry. You want to say something?
I request everyone on the back, please settle down. We'll take another 15 minutes, 10 minutes only, and break for lunch.
Yeah, this is the toughest one anyways, to hold the people for lunch. I'll finish it off fast because I'm hungry as well, so for sure. Okay. So, coming back to the point, we basically started taking cybersecurity very seriously from 2014 onwards, and then the saga continues, right? The number of attacks that keep on growing day by day, and obviously because of the number of malwares that get detected on a daily basis also keeps on growing, right? So this is what it is costing to the overall global economy. $600 billion we lost. We, as in the good people, lost in 2017, $600 billion. You know, what's the scale of $600 billion, just to get you to the perception of what $600 billion means? It's the cost of International Space Station, and we could have actually built 4 International Space Station if we would have used this money for good purpose. So this is a scale of the loss that globally we had. There are specific data that we have for India as well, but I just wanted to keep it very simple in terms of letting you know the relevance of cybersecurity today in the market, okay? In the panel discussion, there was one point brought around the Bangladesh Bank as well. I won't really go into details of this, but in my opinion, this was one of the most expensive typo error that anyone could ever do. The reason why I call it as the most expensive typo error is because when the SWIFT transfer happened, and when it got checked with the bank, and this was a bank in Sri Lanka, they basically said, have you really done the transfer? And that and instead of the word foundation, instead of O, by mistake they had typed A. And this is exactly why this entire thing got exposed, and they were still in position to secure $870 million. They still lost $81 million. But to a country like Bangladesh, losing out $1 billion is like going really bankrupt. That's the scale of impact that it could have got into the economy for Bangladesh. And as per our information, this was a state-sponsored. I guess people understand what is state-sponsored, right? Some country wanted to take this money out to satisfy some of their other missions and fight with someone else, right? I'm not going to go into details of all of this, neither I can, but if you do Google, you will understand a lot about it, okay? We spoke a lot about ATMs, you know, how do you secure ATMs and so on and so forth. You just go to Darknet, you can pay $5,000 on Darknet, and you can get the step-by-step approach of how can you go and hack an ATM. Step-by-step. Any layman can do it. $5,000 is what it costs to go and hack an ATM. It's that simple. We spoke a lot about cameras and, you know, how can you protect the PIN and so on and so forth, but it's nothing. You just go and hack an ATM. Done. I can share with you an experience of a bank in Russia. And, you know, this bank actually, the cyber criminals actually tied up with the local criminals. And they were told that at a specific point in time, let's say 2 a.m. or something, just stand by the ATMs of that specific bank across the city. And the ATMs were dispensing cash automatically. The local guys had to just collect this cash and go home. And obviously they had their share, right? So this is what is happening. It's no more about, in my opinion, it's no more about endpoint security or anything. It's gone much beyond that. It's gone at state levels. It's gone at country levels. It's gone at how can you spoil an economy of a country with an attack. And people are exercising those options. People are doing a lot around it. And it's happening a lot in India as well, by the way. By our data, India is the fifth most attacked country in the world. Fifth most attacked country in the world. How many attacks do we actually come to know? It's just that we are not reporting it. Someone said we are underreported, and that's the fact. Fifth most is not a joke, okay? And that means there's a lot of money which has been lost. And one of the reason is awareness, and there are many other reasons which I'll just let you in a while. Okay, another very important thing which will shape up very soon is on security on IoT. Right? So, you know, sometimes these terms like IoT and so on, it just people don't really understand what it means. But to me, a smart vending machine which dispenses coffee or a smart vending machine which dispenses cold drinks, to me, that's an IoT device. I guess this hotel is a little old, but most of the new hotels where they have the cameras, they are IP-based cameras, and to me, that's an IoT device. What it means is, the number of IoT devices that are shaping up and the attack on those number of IoT devices that is shaping up in the industry, that's as well growing drastically. Look at it on 2016 data and look at it on 2017 data. And with the number of IoT devices which will get implemented further in the industry, look at it in terms of the number of malwares which will get generated on the IoT devices. So look out for the security for your IoT devices. That's going to be very critical, and it's the next wave in terms of cybersecurity and securing your devices. There's one more aspect which I will touch upon in my panel discussion. I won't go into depth of this, but this is again going to be very, very critical. SCADA systems, which for those people who don't understand SCADA systems, it's basically, you know, all our power plants and other large-scale infrastructure which is built by the government. And they all were built on OT, which is operational technologies, right? There is modernization happening in this domain as well, which means that this infrastructure of the countries is also prone to cyber attack. Again, just do Google, I won't name the country. There was an attack on a specific country power plant, and the city went into darkness for 2 days. and they just could not realize what happened. It was nothing to do with the operational technology or the fault of the systems that were in place. It's just that there was a state-sponsored terror attack to cause the damage to the economy of that country. And maybe to take the revenge on something else, which is a social factor. All this is readily available. You just need to do city gone into darkness because of cyber attack, you'll get all your answers there. Okay, this is how a SCADA system looks like. Okay, terrorism, another big problem. To us, it's a bigger problem as well. People are leveraging cybersecurity, they are paying hackers, and they are wanting to create an environment of terrorism. Right, so it's not just talking about a local gang being tied up with a cyber criminal. It's also, they are paid heavily in terms of causing damage to the economy. And this is the easiest way to do it, because you don't need arms for this. All you need is some good minds. You just pay them and they can do the damage for you. Okay? So summary is, the systems need to be safe, they need to be secured, and they need to be safe and secured across the levels. So we are talking of platforms, architecture, and applications. And the security element has to come in across all the levels, not at one level. Having said this, does it really mean that if you deploy this technology, and it doesn't matter from Kaspersky or from my competitors or anyone, do we really feel that we deployed everything from any specific vendor, nothing is going to happen? No, it still will happen. It's like, I just give this example, right? It's like you have police in the city, that does not mean there'll be no crime in the city. Police is there to respond to an incident. Crimes will still happen. The amount of money involved in this is far too high than what we can even estimate. So crimes will happen. It's just of how you can respond to this, how fast you can respond to this. It's like a specific incident that happened probably at your home. If you realize that this incident happened just 5 minutes back, you probably can recover something faster. As compared to something that you realize, okay, it happened 5 days back. The chances are very rare that you can recover. So the point is, incidents will happen. Any technology that you can deploy, it will happen. The question is how fast you can respond to it, how fast you can predict it, and how fast you can prevent it. That's the aspect we got to think around. And it brings me to one of the very interesting concepts that I keep on hearing from customers, right? We have endpoint security deployed. Yeah, but that's something which was required in 2012. You need to get out of the concept of detecting. That story is over. Detecting is one aspect of it. It's about responding. It's about preventing. It's about predicting. And those are the elements which has to get into your organizations as well, which is very, very important and very, very critical if you want to save your data. Right? Next subsequent slides are on same lines. I'm not going to go into details of this. This just talks a little bit about our company. So we're into small and medium business. This is what I was talking in detail about. So how can you detect it? How can you respond it? How can you predict it and prevent it, right? And this is a cycle. So it's not like one time, okay, I did this. I mean, I've seen, and we have done this for a lot of banks, where they send their teams to our training centers in terms of going through the training for incident and response management. I won't name the bank again, but after the training was done, I took the feedback from the participants saying that, okay, how was the training? They said, we were lucky that nothing major happened, because if something major would have happened, that we wouldn't know really how to respond to that, right? So this, to me, is what an enterprise needs to now look for, which is detecting, responding, and predicting. And I guess Gartner also speaks on same lines. Okay, so we need to protect everything, individual business security, industrial security, IoT securities. I'll quickly just leave with this slide in terms of what is it that we got to offer. So we have Kaspersky anti-targeted attack, we have endpoint security, we have cybersecurity services, very critical in my opinion today, because for those customers who have deployed ATPs, who have deployed endpoints, in many industry forums that I've gone to, I've heard the customers saying, cybersecurity is my number two priority on investments. Number one still remains cloud, but number two is cybersecurity. But where is this investment going to happen? It's, in my opinion, it still will happen around strengthening the teams. How the teams can be more capable of responding to an incident. how the teams can be capable of, you know, doing the forensics about a specific incident, how the teams will be capable of, you know, managing the whole infrastructure with some intelligence which is collected from players like us. Because you can't really generate all this intelligence. You've got to buy this intelligence. And that's where I believe, firmly believe, that a lot of investments from the organization should happen, at least for those who have done their investments on endpoint security, mail security, and ATPs. Obviously, if ATP investment is not done, that should remain as your priority. But I would just leave this dais out here with this thought that endpoint security is something that you need to look at 2013 or 2014. It's gone much, much beyond it. And if you're not really serious about this, you'll be part of this 600 billion, right? So just take a note about it. That's all from my side. Thank you very much. I think I was on time.
I would request Mr. Sudipto Biswas, President, Infosec Foundation, to kindly felicitate the speaker with a token of appreciation. Then I would request Mr. Sanjeev Mahapatra to kindly felicitate the speaker with a token of appreciation. Mr. Bhayani, I would request you to come on stage. Thank you so much. Thank you.